I'm here, I've got the poncho.
Spectacular, celebrating 900 years of the history of Guildford. Before we begin tonight's performance, just a couple of notices for your welfare. Should you have a medical emergency, the first aid tent is situated to the rear of the auditorium. There are public toilets opposite the main entrance in Tunsgate, and disabled facilities are located opposite the box office. If at any time you have a query, please ask a steward who are clearly visible in the yellow tabards. In the unlikely event of emergency, please listen to the announcements and follow the directions of the stewards. Please do take care when walking around the site and be patient when leaving. Please switch off all mobile phones and please do not smoke while seated in the auditorium. There must be no flash photography throughout the performance and strobe lighting effects will be used in small part of the event. A CD of the song for Guildford will be a sale after the show at the box office at a cost of £2.50. There is an exhibition of work children have done in association with the show at the Museum of Guildford in Quarry Street. There will also be a cash collection for Abracadabra as the audience leave this evening. And this appeal is for redeveloping the children's ward at the Royal County Hospital. Please give generously. Finally, may you just take this opportunity to wish you an enjoyable evening.
Upon the banks by angel dew was born a town so strong and true, and golden fort from meadows grew.
Golden fort, Guildford, peace, perfect.
Guildford, expect the unexpected. Give me a G.
Ghosts and graves.
Give me a U, an I, and an L.
University, industry, literature.
A D, an F, an O, and an R.
Dominicans and fireworks. Audibles, lectures, and riots.
And give me that final D.
Drinking, disgrace, delightful.
Rule up to this four-square town set in the Surrey Hills. This prosperous place of independent mind. Rackety, roaring, straight-laced, patriotic, perplexing, hard-working, rebellious, and good-humoured. Manners! Ladies and gentlemen, I give you...
Guildford!
Glorious Guildford!
keeper of the gate, the spirit of the ancient hill, the soul of the castle stones. I have seen all, I have heard all, and I shall tell some of it. To begin, a massacre. In this year, in this place, an act of bloody treachery. And treachery to the brother of our future king, Edward the Confessor.
My lord Alfred Atheling, you and your people are welcome here. We send greetings to your royal brother.
My dear Earl Godwin, your loyalty and hospitality are unquestioned. So, this is Guildford.
The company feasts and retires. But some men do not sleep.
Soldier, I do not trust this Atheling. He is plotting against his brother. Are we all armed?
Aye, my lord. And the hot irons are ready.
Good. Then kill them.
My lord Godwin!
You, I do not kill.
Thank God.
Your eyes blind you.
Two 200 bent and broken skeletons lay mouldering under Gildan. Accept hospitality in Guildford at your peril. Now, the unexpected. I give you Mr. P.G. Woodhouse.
I say, Jeeves, bury Aunt Flavia has only been down to her place in Guildford. Dead and alive, though, I dare say.
On the contrary, sir. Guildford has the ruins of an interesting medieval castle.
Medieval castle, eh? Fascinating.
Henry II built the present stone structure, and King John stayed here.
Jeeves.
Henry III made it a most luxurious royal palace. It was he who had the ceiling of the king's chamber painted in green, spangled with gold and silver.
Jeeves!
And at Christmas in 1347, Edward III held his masked revels here. The proceedings were, I fear, somewhat bacchanalian.
Ah, that's more like it.
Bacchanalian and winter. The king himself wore the headdress of a swan.
His guests were dragons,
birds of paradise, griffins, wild men.
Also, my lord dragon, a wild and willing woman.
Come with me to the basement, my naughty little paradise bird.
I say, hijinks in the basement, Jeeves. Golly.
Doubtless to the surprise of the inmates, sir.
Inmates? Was it a lunatic?
The county jail, sir, housing murderers, felonists, and counterfeiters.
Come again?
Since the year 975, Guildford had its own mint. Anyone caught coining had the hand severed at the wrist. Like this. Your cocktail, sir. Ah.
Now, parsonical pleasures and ecclesiastical exploits.
Lay hold of life and it shall be.
Step forward, the Reverend J.B. Monsell.
My joy and crown is earned.
John Monsell speaking. Wrote the hymn you're listening to. Stirring tune, ain't it? Incumbent of St. Nicholas, Guildford, building in shocking state, 1874, built a new one. Never saw it finished. Whilst inspecting the works, tripped over a gravestone. That was that. Can't be helped.
Cherry ripe, cherry ripe, ripe, I cry. Fool and fair ones come and buy.
Market day, 1740. The Tower of Holy Trinity stands proudly over the high street.
But not for long.
Took 23 years to rebuild it. First thing, a young whippersnapper climbs to the top. On the outside.
When I get you home, John Russell, I'll tan your eye.
Go on, lad, go on. And Holy Trinity had a role to play even in World War II, when the landmark Guildhall clock was stored in the crypt for safekeeping. Now, more clerical curiosities.
My mother dreamed that if she caught a pike, then she would bear a son who would become a great man. Me. The pike got eaten. I never really wanted to be Archbishop of Canterbury. And to be honest, I wasn't much good at it.
This man, Abbott, all his work translating the King James Bible, is not the man to heal the rift within our church.
This is Bishop William Lord, who caused the rift in the first place. In truth, I was happier in Guildford, and most proud of the almshouses I built in the High Street.
The Hospital of the Blessed Trinity to house 12 brothers and 8 sisters to live out their days in peace, comfort, and charity. Married persons, you know.
Not a great deal else happened to me, I'm afraid. No, come to think of it, I did once kill a man. My dear fellow, I am most dreadfully sorry.
This incompetent Archbishop Abbott goes a-hunting with a crossbow and bags not a deer, but a gamekeeper. Not content with splitting the church, he now splits men's scalps.
This detestable Bishop Lord succeeded me as Archbishop, and in turn had his own skull split by the executioner. I retired to my backwater of Surrey, saddened only by my old birthplace becoming the Three Mariners Alehouse. Oh well. Still, as I look down, I can say that I am much pleased with our new cathedral. I think.
May 1961, and Britain's newest cathedral in the bustling Surrey town of Guildford is at last consecrated, only 35 years late, and it's thanks to Adolf for halting proceedings for 6 years. Mr. Leslie Codd, the mayor of Guildford, had this to say of the town's newest jewel.
From the outside, it looks like a blessed furniture factory. But inside, it is one of the most beautiful things I have ever seen.
And so it is. Designed by architect Edward Morph in the classic Odeon style of the 1930s, it is a glorious spiritual oasis of peace and light. The lofty teak cross outside was made of timbers from the battleship HMS Ganges. Situated on top of Stag Hill, among the picturesque Surrey Hills, you need a stout pair of legs to climb up to the Cathedral of the Holy Spirit, which is why the nave is dedicated to the motorists of Surrey. Over £50,000 was raised through the Buy a Brick campaign at half a crown a throw. Well done, people of Guildford. What bricks you be!
And last, but not least, St. Mary's. our oldest church, from whose pulpit once preached the most imaginative cleric of them all, the Reverend Charles Dodgson, better known to the world as the one and only Mr. Lewis Carroll.
Will you, won't you, will you, won't you, won't you join the dance?
Once upon a time, Mr. Carroll stayed in a house called the Chestnut, hard by the castle grounds,
said Alice.
Stuff and nonsense,
said the Mad Hatter.
How can a house be a chestnut? You should say what you mean.
But I mean what I say. That's the same thing.
Not the same thing a bit. Next, you'll be asking us to believe that Mr. Carroll lived in a chestnut with six spinster sisters.
But he did. Their names were Frances, Elizabeth, Caroline, Louisa, Margaret, and Henrietta. You see, I can believe in six spinster sisters before breakfast. Please continue.
But oh, beamish nephew, beware of the day. If your snark be a poojum for them, you will softly and suddenly vanish away and never be met with again.
Exactly. Mr. Carroll invented the hunting of the snark whilst walking on the hog's back.
I did indeed,
said Mr. Carroll.
For there is something about Guildford which inspired me to write nonsense.
The time has come, Miss Alice said, to talk of sad things. How Lewis Carroll caught a cold, with all the trouble that brings.
Hulloo, Calais! He was borne away on the backs of angels' wings, and lies forever on crocodile feathers with cabbages and games.
Reverend Charles Dodgson died on January 4, 1898. He was 66 years old and is buried with his sisters in the Mount Cemetery. That's all. The end.
Quite right. Begin at the beginning and go on till you come to the end. Then stop.
Arthurian legend, my Camelot was set at Winchester, and Lancelot, on his way to see the king, follows a river and rests a night at a sweet town by name Astolat, a Breton word. This town now, in English, is called Goldenfall, or Guildford. Also, I heard tell of a fair maid of Astolat, which fell in love with my Lancelot, and her name was Elaine. And she did sing most melodiously.
By golden sand and waters blue, stands there still and so sweet and true. My love and I lay in the dew. By golden sands and waters blue.
I say, Jeeves, Guildford's got its fair share of artistic coves. One, who's our little furry friend in the boat?
Over water rat, or more correctly, water vole, sir. An anthropomorphic creature from the wind and the moon.
There is nothing absolutely nothing. Half so much worth doing as simply messing about in boats.
Said the water rat.
Isn't it funny how a bear likes honey? Buzz, buzz, buzz. I wonder why he does.
Said Mr. E.H. Shepherd, the famous illustrator who lived at Shamley Green.
I think it was the light of the gentle Surrey countryside which inspired me, as it had John Russell in the 18th century. He was the young lad who climbed the church tower, remember? The wind in the willows was a dreamlike Arcadia, and my experiences as a war artist in Flanders in 1916 came as a great shock. It was a relief to come back to Surrey and to my children's books. Dear God, that was a dreadful war.
What Parson Bells were these who die as cattle? Only the monstrous anger of the guns, the shrill, demented choirs of wailing shells, and bugles calling them from sad shires.
And from Guildford, 492 country boys marched unknowingly to the gates of hell. 492 boys who were never again to see their sad shine of Surrey.
Move him into the sun. Gently its touch awoke him once, a hermit, whispering of fields half sown.
A spectacular reconstruction of a front-line trench standing between the castle grounds and the draper's shop. See the ruined church. Marvel of 200,000 sandbags. £15.06 buys 124 cartridges. Dig deep, Guildford.
Congratulations, Guildford. Flanders by Moonlight has raised 310,197 pounds. Now, let's go and bash the horse.
So, this is Guildford, yeah?
Sit down, you fool! You are bearing this spike, he'll beat!
They trample the ladies and steal the seat with their up to your butt and their down to your gun.
It's over, St. Catherine Schmeichel.
Reckon he's headed for the gunpowder factory at Chilworth.
Or following the railway line to London and the Woolwich Arsenal, Sergeant.
I'll take a pop at him with my rifle.
So, you want to pull off, Tommy? Then bombs away!
Report to GHQ on Guildford Zeppelin raid, October 15, 1915. 12 hand bombs were dropped on the outskirts of the town. Dead include 15 chickens and a swan. The cow was severely damaged. There is no doubt that Guildford will experience future aerial attacks, and every precaution must be put in place urgently.
Determined fight against the Nazi menace, Guildford is playing its small part. World-famous fire engine manufacturer Dennis Brothers has turned over its production to a magnificent new weapon, the Churchill tank. Hooray for Winston!
Hooray!
And hooray, too, for a world-famous mathematician, cryptologist, and father of the modern computer. Let's hear from Mr. Alan Turing, whose family lived here in the Magnolias in Ennismore Avenue, Guildford.
As a boy, I would stand in the garden of the Magnolias and gaze at the stars to work out some mathematical problem. I could not guess where my facility for numbers would take me.
In fact, it took Guildford's precocious genius to Bletchley Park, the top secret wartime center for intercepting German intelligence messages. Here, Alan Turing worked on decoding the devilish Enigma cipher machine which sent orders to U-boats in the Atlantic.
It can be done. It must be done. It can be done. It must be done.
And by Jove, it was done.
Eureka!
And thousands of Allied lives were saved as a result.
And I'm flattered that they want to put a sculpture of me by John Mills on the piazza outside the university's computing department. I have fond memories of Guildford, and I'm glad it escaped the ravages of war.
Not quite, Alan. In 1940, the threat of invasion results in the building of pillboxes along the North Downs. Tank traps are dug by the River Wey, seen as a weak point of defense if the Germans advance from the south coast. It's possible that Monty and Rommel might not have met in the desert, but in Surrey. And the Battle of Alamein would have been the Battle of Guildford Gap. Watch out! Jerry's about! Take cover! Once again, Germany brings aerial warfare to Guildford. On the 16th of December, 1942, young Donald Moore, a clerk at Friary New Brewery, was on lookout at the top of the brewery tower.
About lunchtime, Adornia 217 dropped two bombs on a train at Brownlee Station, killing seven people. Minutes later, the same plane came flying towards the tower of me. You can see the crew sitting in the cockpit. It opened fire with its machine gun and hit the old Surrey Hospital and the county school. No one got hurt. I ducked. I was so scared. But even more scary was in 1944 when the Jerrys started sending over the V-1 and V-2 unmanned rockets. Buzz bombs, we called them. First, you heard it approaching. You hoped it kept going, because when the motor suddenly cut out, you knew there were 10 seconds silence before it crashed and exploded. But you never knew where. And 10 seconds is a long time in the dark, I can tell you. Listen.
Thank you.
5 buzz bombs fell around the town. Must have been strays. I mean, why would it though want to attack Guildford?
Why indeed? But mercifully, our beautiful town was spared the worst, and having helped in the deliverance of our island race, Guildford went on to live in its customary peace and prosperity.
Enmities are long past. For the past 25 years, Guildford has been twinned with the delightful southwest German city of Freiburg, capital of the Black Forest. Freiburg, too, has its cathedral and university, and is noted for its excellence in sport and culture, as well as being world famous for its environmental achievements. Peace and prosperity. But whence came Guildford's prosperity?
Guildford had a flock of sheep, their fleece was white as snow. The wool was shorn, but fort was worn. They dyed it blue with woad.
Children, have you minded your lessons?
Yes, sir. In 1128, the Cistercian monks introduced commercial wool production to the downs of West Surrey.
The sheep were shorn and the fleeces taken to the spinners in large square wool sacks.
This is why there are 2 wool sacks on the town's coat of arms.
Next came the leaves of a plant called woad.
They were mashed up to a brilliant yellow dye, which, on contact with water, turned blue.
The famous Guildford blue. Carry on.
The blue cloth was then put on wax to dry, hence the name of wax clothes in the town. But the trade died out because of cheating.
Cheating?
Yes. The Chinese clothiers began stretching the cloth before it dried to make it go further.
But if the customer wearing it got caught in the rain, it would suddenly shrink to half its size.
Cheating in Guildford? Inconceivable. But by the 1600s, Guildford blue had died of shame. So what was left?
Water from the Surrey hills, water for the tap, water for the water mill and your cows to lap, water for a boat to float far and far away, water, water everywhere from the river way.
Of our Lord, 1651. I, Sir Richard Weston of Sutton Place.
And I, James Fitzel, Major in our Lord Protector Oliver Cromwell's Model Army, do in Chief of Parliament an act sanctioning the widening of the River Wey so that it shall be navigable for 2 barges from the Thames to Guildford.
The scheme will open up trade in timber, grain and coal
and we envisage the construction of 12 locks and 9 miles of canal. Estimated cost £16,000. We await the pleasure of Parliament.
Parliament grants the said application, and the Guildford Corporation and others to make the way navigable at their own expense.
Which, being translated, means my expense.
Weston, you're a papist and a monarchist. Your entire scheme would have foundered but for my championship. You'll make your fortune, man. Trust me.
Weston was trusting. Too trusting.
bankrupt and imprisoned? Oh!
One man, and I wonder who, by dodgy share dealing and embezzlement, did secure a tidy sum with which he purchased the Pale House at Stoke.
1,000, 2,000, 3,000.
You've got to pick a pocket or two.
The upright Major Pitson goes on to become Justice of the Peace.
But you cannot prove that all was not above board.
Vanish, rapscallion!
Water for a fainting place, far and far away. Water, water everywhere, from the river way.
And water with which to make certain potable libations enjoyed throughout the town.
Clubs, bars, cafes.
Glass, neon, style.
Relax with your friends.
Have a laugh.
Great food, dancing, music.
Like really loud music. Noisy drinking into the list.
Yeah, Guildford's really changing.
Quite a sexy place now. Nah, don't go to pubs much.
Well, pubs are old men and warm beer. My dad told me there's always been loads of pubs here, even breweries.
What? You mean there were breweries in Guildford?
Does water flow downhill? Of course there were breweries in Guildford.
Mr. Boyer of Stout Brewery begs to inform his numerous customers that he now has stock of pale ales brewed in March from Malt and Farnham hops alone, which are in splendid condition.
The Broadman Brewery at Shelford begs to inform the nobility, gentry and clergy that they are now able to supply their celebrated porter and stout in pint bottles.
Say, Jeeves, they like their browsing and sluicing in Guildford, what?
Indeed, sir. By the year 1900, there were 7 breweries here.
7? Crikey! And hostelries galore, no doubt.
I fear so. The so-called water poet of Surrey, one John Taylor, recorded in the 17th century.
The town hath very fair inns and good entertainment at the taverns. The Angel, the Crown, the White Hart, and the Red Lion. Our gracious King Charles II rested at the Red Lion, as did once the disreputable diarist Mr. Pepys.
July 10th, the chambermaids of the Red Lion are most comely, though somewhat prudish. But particular, I did much relish the asparagus grown in the inn's garden.
And during the latter years, the reign of Queen Victoria, sir, there were 80 inns and beer shops in Guildford, and 30 in the High Street alone.
God! And a few sore heads, I dare say.
I am sorry to say, sir, that in the 1890s, Guildford was not a byword for sobriety.
The accused will please remember that this is a court of law.
Oh, no.
Continue, Constable Gainston.
On Saturday last, I found the accused, Elizabeth Bartlett, in commercial road, shouting and using obscene language.
So what if I had a drop or two in the dolphin? So would you if you was married to a good-for-nothing horse dealer? What beat me regular?
Madam, you gave the same performance last week. I am prepared to give you one more chance, on condition that you take the pledge.
Oh, I will, your worship. Honest.
Next case.
Joseph Cochran Gump, employed as a porter at the White Lion Hotel.
Cochran found dead drunk in the Shelford Road. Upon his person, I found gold and silver coins, jewellery, 50 cigars, and a bottle of port. Cochran confessed to breaking into the Jolly Farmer public house and purloined insane.
Disgraceful. 3 months with hard labour.
Fair enough, Gov. But to be honest, there ain't a lot else to do in Guildford.
I say, Jeeves, was the whole of Guildford under the influence?
Very nearly, sir. However, the esteemed Guildford Institute started life as a temperance hotel.
Ah.
But in 1871, the allure of the public house, I regret to say, was not confined to the shiftless classes. Witness the fire at Stoke Mill.
Fire! Fire! Where the hell is the brigade?
They were called an hour ago, Master.
The borough is much indebted to the volunteer firemen of Guildford, but whilst acknowledging the speed with which the brigade was dispatched to douse the flames at Stoke Mill, we question the necessity of its stopping off for 20 minutes at the Prince Albert Public House. Gentlemen, consider yourselves fortunate to receive only a public reprimand.
Alas, some misguided miscreants received a public flogging. The last in 1824, at the hands of Guildford's only flagellating brewer, Mayor William Elkins.
Billy Whip, Billy Bum, from a basket made a sprung, to a grocer he was found, then got Mayor of Guildford Town.
John Davies, on November the 30th last at the Swan Ale House, you were heard to say that you wished the French to invade and cut all the English into mincemeat.
I did. I also said damn and blast the mayor and all that supports him.
Tie this man to the cart tail and whip him up the high street and down again.
And I don't regret it.
Well, John Davies, what have you got to say for yourself now?
I still say damn and blast the mayor.
Oh, good fun. Other unfortunates were not necessarily criminal, but might just as well have been.
We've been together now for 40 years. And it don't seem a day too much.
Pursuant to the Poor Law Amendment Act of 1836, the Board of Guardians are pleased to build in Warren Road the Guildford Union Workhouse.
But there ain't another in the whole world as us what poor dear old Dutch.
Any paupers in need of charitable relief will be accommodated therein. Rules?
1. Upon admission, all inmates to be stripped, bathed, disinfected, and issued with a uniform.
2. Men and women to be segregated and kept in separate cells.
Good night, me duck.
Good night, my love.
Silence! Talking is strictly forbidden and will result in expulsion. Rule 3. On rising, all able-bodied women to scrub cells and corridors, men to be issued with hammers to break stones for road building. Only when the tasks are completed may the pauper have breakfast.
I trust you two people are sensible of the kindness being afforded you.
Oh, yes, sir.
You kindly, sir. Report to the Guildford Board of Guardians, 1850. The Union Workhouse is now largely populated by the elderly, sick, disabled, and by the children of unmarried women.
We ask, have the lower classes abandoned all sense of morality?
The Warren Road Workhouse closed only in 1930. Let us lift the gloom.
My lords, ladies and gentlemen, for your delectation and delight, we are proud, pleased and privileged to present Guildford, our world of entertainment!
100 years of Rabelaisian excess.
Mr. Punch performing now. That's the way to do it.
Oysters! Fresh oysters!
Coconuts, green balls and apples!
Madame Mercator will foretell your future. Crystal ball gazing and palms read by a genuine Roman.
This is Manly's Museum of Science and Nature and Heart. See the pre-forming pony. Marvel at the pre-forming dogs. And also beats of Roger Domeni, otherwise conjuring. Hey, Presto!
And beer. We could sell homegrown beer at St. Cat's. Lethal stuff, leading to fisticuffs and ferment.
400 very low and drunken characters from Guildford rioted at the fair. My top hat was stamped on, and Mrs. Piggott had her bonnet rammed down over her ears.
Hello!
So they stopped us selling our beer in 1863. St. Cat's was never the same and finally died in 1913. R.I.P. So, from the debauched to the decorous, for the genteel such as yourselves, the castle pleasure grounds were opened in 1888.
It is all most charming. A waterfall, crossed by rustic bridges, runs down into a lake below. And on one side of the keep is a plateau, from which a splendid view of the town and country beyond can be obtained. Splendid!
Next, an extraordinary character. I give you the one, the only, the supreme showman from the United States of America, Colonel William F. Cody, known to millions as Buffalo Bill!
Open the Deadwood stage is rolling on over the plain, with the curtain snapping and the driver slapping the rain. A beautiful sky, a wonderful day. Whip, crack away, whip, crack away.
Yee-haw! So, this is Surrey, eh? You ain't seen nothing like this, folks. And we had Buffalo Bill at Chalford Park. Can you imagine?
See the genuine recreation of the Wild West frontier by over 20 cowboys. Gasp at the daredevil exploits on horseback.
Thrill to the battle of Little Big Horn.
Marvel Augusta's last stand and heroic fall. Everything guaranteed authentic by Colonel Cody himself.
Ladies and gentlemen, we've been touring all over your wonderful country, but we ain't seen no place so mighty fine as your beautiful town of Great Yarmouth.
This is Guildford, Bill.
Beautiful town of Guildford. This is positively our last appearance until the next time, so just you give a big hand now to the prettiest partner a man could wish for, little Miss Shirtshot herself, Annie Oakley.
This is Guildford. Hold on to your hats, boys.
Well, I guess it's about time for the wagon train to ride off into the sunset. Nice meeting y'all. Hope you enjoyed the show. Let's keep going.
Boys, what a wonderful life he spent in daring deeds wherever he went. Long may his exploits healthily thrill. Let's take our hats off to Buffalo Bill!
That was entertainment indeed. And now for something completely different.
Don't put your daughter on the stage, Mrs. Worthington. Don't put your daughter on the stage.
My name is Yvonne Arnaud.
I was born in Aquitaine in France, but you English like my acting, so I stay here. I live in London Road, Guildford. I am very proud that the theatre by the old watermill bears my name. But we have a much older theatrical tradition in the town.
I desire the Right Honourable Lord Grantley, Steward of the Races, and Mr. Thornton's Theatre in the Red Lion Yard, Guildford, on Wednesday, July the 11th, 1832, will be presented Mr. Sheridan's celebrated comedy of The Rivals.
And afterwards, a comic song by Mr. Renault, a sailor's hornpipe by Mr. Pitt, and a Scotch dance by Master Elliot. Boxes, 3 shillings, pit, 2 shillings, gallery, 1 shilling.
Oh la la, those were the days.
Don't put your mother on the page.
But before I am an actress, I am a concert pianist. So I adore the music in the town. We have the splendid Guildford Symphony Orchestra. But we can also embrace modern ideas. The music you are listening to is Leila by Eric Clapton, a famous son of Repier near Guildford, and Kerstin McCall, a much-loved and sadly missed singer, visited the town in the year 2000 to open the Academy of Contemporary Music in the old Harbour Building.
Good God, Guildford!
Thank you. So there you have it, Guildford. A world of entertainment. That is all.
Not quite all, Mademoiselle Arnum.
Remember, remember the faith of my member. God, our treason, our God. I see no reason why powder and treason should ever be forgot.
From the mists of time, entertainment guaranteed. I give you the unconquerable, the unchallengeable, the ungovernable Guildford Girlies.
Suffer this anarchy each November. The scoundrels break our windows, tear down our fences, and light huge bonfires in the very high street.
Sir, they chant obscenities and effect grotesque masks in order to intimidate the populace.
Knives to stab. They carry the most fearsome weapons. Boots to tear flesh.
Under the pretense of a rural tradition, the rag, bag, and bobtail of the fields and slum streets indulge in nothing less than vicious hooliganism.
Mr. Mayor, something must be done.
Torch the town, light the fire, master!
I, Henry Piper, Mayor of Guildford, do hereby invoke the Riot Act of 1715 and order the mob to disperse,
on pain of imprisonment or transportation.
Oh, yeah? Well, here's a squib to make you up, Mr. Mayor.
Oh, ow, oh, ow. Superintendent, order the constables to the fray. Oh, ow, oh, ow.
Hello! Hello! Hello!
Give no quarter, man.
Here they come, boys! Stir them!
Nails to stare!
Books to tear flesh!
Ready, men!
Charge! Hold him down!
Bastard, Bobby!
My eyes! Oh, God, my eyes!
Here's another feeder! Get you!
My head! My head! Mercy, I beg!
From the Home Secretary to the Mayor of Guildford. The events of November the 5th, 1862 are a disgrace, not only to your town, but to the nation as a whole. Constable Stett had his eye gouged from the socket, and Constable Davis's face is disfigured beyond recognition. Such violence can no longer be tolerated. Consequently, next year, a company of 150 men of the 1st Royal Dragoons from Aldershot will be sent to keep the peace. Sir, we will put your house in order.
Company, halt! Prepare to fire.
Hold steady, guys. Hold steady. They're only mini-limit soldier boys.
If this mob does not disperse immediately, I have orders to fire first over your heads, and thereafter you take the consequences. What do you say?
What do we say?
We are the champions! We are the champions!
Company! Ready! Aim! Fire!
Detain the ringleaders!
Kingston Assizes Court, November 1863. You men are charged with offences against the Public Order Act at Guildford on November 5th. State your names and how you plead.
William Nugent,
painter.
Age 29.
Guilty.
John Pearson, coachsmith. Age 23. Guilty.
Edwin Reeves, cooper. Age 26. Not guilty.
Let me inform you three gentlemen that terrorizing a town, setting fire to property, and brutally beating the defenseless can no longer be excused as entertainment. Nugent and Pearson, you are convicted of rioting and will go to prison for 6 months. Edwin Reeves, you are convicted of rioting and causing bodily harm. You will go to prison for 12 months with hard labor.
Oh, well, Mr. Judge, sir, that's that. There'll never be no more Guildford Guy riots.
And there weren't. Rioters or romantics?
Heroes or hooligans? Take your pick.
The old place is certainly a lot quieter without them. Dim the lights, roll up the tents, load the caravans. That's our foursquare town of independent mind. This rackety, roaring, straight-laced, hard-working, good-humoured jewel.
Houses, houses. In Guildford, houses and bungalows, hotels, restaurants and flats, arterial roads, bypasses, petrol pumps and highways. Are these going to be England? Or is there another England, green and eternal, which will outlast them? I cannot tell you. But this land is yours, and you can make it what you will. If you want to ruin our Surrey fields and woodlands, it is very easy to do. And if you want to save them, they can be saved. Look into your hearts and look into the past and remember that this beauty is a gift which you can never replace and which no money can buy. You can make a town, you can make a desert, you can even make a garden. But you can never, never make the country, because it was made by time. William Coppet wrote of Guildford, "It is one of the most agreeable and most happy-looking places that I ever saw in my life." Let us keep it that way.
Amen. This ancient tower, this golden fall, is rich in its past, and it is rich in its present. Just look at our riches. A wealth of learning at university and college and law school. A wealth of commerce and consumerism. For here you may shop till you drop, drink your fill and dine on a humble hamburger or haute cuisine. And a wealth of recreation with a riverside the envy of the south. The very hum of Surrey, despite what Kingston may think. And we shall be rich in our future. I know, for I am the keeper of the gate, the spirit of the ancient hill, the soul of the castle walls. I see all, I hear all. Guildford, expect the unexpected.
thieves? This Guildford sounds a bit of a hot spot after all.
You are not then averse to a visit, sir?
Lead me to it, Jeeves. Lead me to it!
Ladies and gentlemen, we hope you have enjoyed this evening's performance. We bid you good night and wish you a safe journey home. Good night.